Good afternoon to all of you. Most of us are now quite awake after the wonderful lunch that we had a few hours ago. It's indeed an honor to be here this afternoon, especially, you know, if some of you have been here since morning, then at the inaugural session, we heard various colleagues and the leader of our state talk about the vision. The vision about taking India, taking Gujarat, and preparing Gujarat for the next 50 years. So that's the relevance of this international conference for academic institutions. I'm very, very proud to be here, to be a speaker. At the onset, I, you know, you may be seeing this picture. He's my beloved father. I want to dedicate my deliberations this afternoon to a lot of good things that he did, he said, and he shared, and he brought us up with, but something which was very critical and relevant to what we have been talking since morning and will continue to talk till tomorrow, which is his true belief in India. He is an elderly man who was born, brought up, educated in India, and saw India before independence, fought for independence, and saw it through. And so he, through his experience, believes truly and believed truly that the true celebration of research lies as much as in inventions as making, because he's in the life sciences area, making medicines affordable for the last man in society. And so that takes me to a prelude of today's discussion, which is the fundamental of academics and relevance of academics is just not to you know, produce graduates, undergraduates, diplomas, degree holders, employable citizens. But at some stage also education and centers of excellence and knowledge in universities have this tremendous responsibility, duty, if I were to say, to create knowledge, to do innovations, to create a path for innovations. As we've talked and heard, it's because as we go forward, we all believe that it's only because of innovations that we could create and bring to the modern world novel technologies, products and services, which when deployed effectively would lead to growth and economic development of a society, and which in turn would hopefully increase the equality among the social populations. So it is for this better tomorrow that there is importance of innovation. And it's in that background, I thought that I'll take a case study of what we've learned from the history of developed economies. The history, and I don't have a chart to show you, but as we have heard since morning, there is tremendous help, support, and resource allocation given by governments, public endowments, so that institutions are built, like the PDPU, where hopefully over time there is discovery, technology demonstrations leading to development. And it's only at that stage that industry would take up such innovations, would take up such ideas and develop them into commercially viable products. So what is required for the development of a center of excellence? Good question, very difficult to answer, and I think we've heard repeatedly since morning that nobody really has an answer. But what is relevant is that as societies have to grow, as societies have to become more developed and involved, there is a tremendous need for having centers of excellence. And it is the commitment of resource allocation from the government, from the industry, and from the policymakers, which will enable to create a platform for development of centers of excellence. We'll take an example of the various academic institutions in India. An example which comes very relevant to pharmaceuticals is a leading science institute in the south of India, the Indian Institute of Science. Indian Institute of Science out of Bangalore is considered today as one of the leading institutes in India for research in biology and life sciences. It has an ecosystem of over 50 plus years, where there are at least 100 life sciences professors who dedicate their life to do discovery research in biology. Now, in an ecosystem like that, if government or industry were to establish a center, but give a focus on research, focus on ideas and problems and issues and challenges which are relevant to the industry for which there are no solutions, and then if there is a collaborative participation where industry gives its resources, industry continues to pose the challenge, and the scientific community gives their expertise to resolve the problem, I think there is a hope of creating a center of excellence. What will sustain a center like that? As we all know, only were these institutes going to give a commercially viable product which can earn revenue and profits, there is sustenance. Research is a very risky business, as we all know. And so the probability of success of any new product is very, very limited. Again, what it says is, and there was a single underlying theme of my communication and sharing this afternoon, is as India, as Gujarat, as India wants to develop into a more evolved, developed economy, I think there needs to be a unison in thought process. Right from the political leadership, a clear indication that we want to have a more progressive, a more developed, a more educated society, to allocation of resources in various budgets. We heard the country of Singapore has decided to have 3% of its GDP in its academic institutions. I think India has to go a long, long, long way. We, with such a huge economy, if you deploy 3 to 6% of your GDP into higher education, into education, we will have the resources. And if these resources are not wasted, there is a scope of these monetary resources getting used for development and sustenance of academic institutions. So the message really I have is quite different from, you know, what we heard about Karlsruhe, about the geothermal experiences, about the diagnostics for using GOES, and also your very specific example of creating the Center of Excellence in Nanotechnology in Nadi. But I think for us, these are small examples. We have to think big. In the area of life sciences, there are huge challenges. Challenges of creating new medications are not a 1 crore, 2 crore, 5 crore in business. It is known very, very commonly now that to bring a new drug into the world market is a $2 billion check. Where are we going to get these resources? If India has to bring new innovations, new products, new medicine into this world, we need tremendous support of the government. And I think with this plea, I say it's possible to make it in India, because we have heard since morning that there have been centers of excellence in our past. We don't have them now, and we do not have them in the horizon. So before it gets too late, I urge through this forum, through the government, that we dedicate, at least in our state and through the country, enhanced resources so that we can start thinking of creating centers of excellence. Thank you very much.